Just go ahead and use those candles and then pass it down as we go. If anybody didn't get a chance to grab one, go ahead and raise your hand, and Jim is in the back there, and he can hook you up with what you need. So if anybody needs one, go ahead, raise your hand, and Jim will get you. If you don't want to raise your hand and you have a cell phone, you know, feel free to take out your flashlight app and kind of wave that during Silent Night. That'd be great. I would love that. So tonight's message is called Faith Over Fear. In hindsight, after I titled that, I was thinking about it today. I'm like, that might sound a little political. It has nothing to do with politics, right? So we're going to look at Mary and Joseph and how their faith really overcame any kind of fear and how that would have impacted Jesus, their son, which I think is pretty cool. So I'm hoping that tonight, you know, the music that we sing together, the message that we reflect on, I'm hoping that all of that's going to just serve to encourage us wherever we are on our journey of faith. It's Christmas time. It's a time of celebration, but I also recognize it can be a hard time for a lot of us because there might be some memories of loss and that kind of stuff that's wrapped up in this Christmas season. So I'm hoping that the music and the message will encourage all of us with that message of peace, no matter where we're at in our life. So with that, let's continue in worship. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you that we can be here tonight to worship you. I pray that all of our worship, the music, the reading of your scripture, our prayer, our response to the message, I pray all of that would not be in vain, and yet that it would be glorifying and honoring to you this evening. So, Lord, I ask that you would penetrate our hearts as we reflect on you and your son that you sent to die for our sins, your son that conquered death so that through faith in him we can be in a right relationship with you and really adopted into your forever family. So Lord, we thank you for that. And as we sing tonight, again, may our worship just glorify and honor you. And we pray in the matchless name of Jesus. Amen.
Would you stand and sing with us?
All right, let's pray. Lord, as we reflect on you over these next however many minutes for the remainder of this service, I pray that you would speak to us in a new way this evening, Lord. Speak to our hearts wherever we're at. Encourage our faith. Encourage those that maybe don't know you, that that they would want to seek you all the more. And so, Lord, I also ask that you would help me as I deliver this message. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so tonight we have gathered to reflect on the birth of Jesus. And as I was thinking about that earlier this week, I just couldn't help but think of the man that Jesus grew up to be. Now, we have the advantage of hindsight, right? We can look back and we can see that Jesus turned out to be someone that stood up for the poor and helped those in need. And really, I mean, unless it was absolutely necessary, Jesus never really backed away from any challenge or anyone that opposed him. He would often just kind of bravely speak his mind, wouldn't he? And when the time came, I just couldn't help but think of Jesus, you know, facing the cross with a heart that put others above his own. I mean, he bravely faced humiliation and physical persecution and even death on the cross. And you know, we think about that, and on one hand, Jesus is God, right? So it's almost a little weird to think of God being brave, right? And it just kind of makes sense that, you know, for Jesus being God, if anyone, you know, could have handled going to the cross the way Jesus did, it was him, okay? But on the other hand, Jesus was also 100% human, right? That means that he had all the emotions and physical limitations that you and I have. You might remember what happened at the Garden of Gethsemane as Jesus was praying to God the Father the night before he was crucified. And he's basically praying and crying out to the Lord and asking if there's any other way, you know, any other way that people could be saved from their sins. But at the end of the day, he said, "Not my will, Lord, but yours be done." He was willing to submit to the Father's will, no matter what. But again, you know, the very fact that Jesus was God almost makes us forget that he was human as well. And we have to remember, you know, when Jesus walked the earth, it wasn't like he was, you know, Superman, right? Yeah, Superman. How many of you like Superman? All right, good. You're in good company, because I do too. Superman, you know, okay, he's a fictional character. But just hang with me for a second on this one. Just go with me. Superman doesn't feel physical pain like you and I do. Bullets bounce off of him, right? If he falls, he doesn't have to worry about twisting his ankle. And if he steps on a Lego, actually, even that might bring down Superman, because that's pretty bad. But seriously, I think you get my point. You know, Jesus, it's not like he was this Superman kind of person, right? Just because he's God. I mean, remember, he's 100% human. So he experienced physical pain just like you and I do. And when he suffered, he really suffered. He knew exactly the kind of suffering that he was looking at when he was headed to the cross. In fact, while he was praying about it in the Garden of Gethsemane, his anxiety spiked so much to the point where the scripture says that he began sweating what looked like drops of blood. And we know that's actually a medical condition stemming from extreme anxiety. But here's the thing, you know, even with all those nerves, even with that extreme anxiety that Jesus faced as he's heading to the cross, he didn't turn his back on the Father's will and run the other way, did he? He faced it. He could have run. Actually, he didn't need to run. He could have just called down an army of angels and then just been done with it, right? Scripture even says that. But Jesus was willing to face this unimaginable suffering, the very suffering that you and I actually deserve because of our sin. And Jesus chose to take on our suffering and die for us so that through him we can not only be saved from our sins, but also, as we've been saying all through this series, adopted into his forever family as children of God. And so I think about the bravery that he displayed on his journey to the cross. Where did he learn that? Is it just programmed into his DNA because, you know, he's also God? Maybe, but he also learned it, right? Jesus learned a lot of things, and he had examples of this kind of courage. I actually suspect his courage was really a learned trait that came from his parents, Mary and Joseph. And so we're gonna see that tonight. I'm sure all of us who are parents know to some extent that our kids really are the product of their surroundings, right? Whatever traits we model for our kids, whether they're good or bad, and whether we even realize it or not, those traits become internalized and ingrained in our kids. I mean, for instance, you know, those of you that are wives, has your husband ever said, you know, you sound just like your mom right now? You know, husbands, right? Has your wife ever said, you know, you sound just like your dad right now? I mean, like it or not, it's true. We do sound like our parents, right? We grow up to be our own person, but we're very much the product of our parents. Whether our parents are biological or whether they're adopted or some other form of parenthood, we inherently graft those traits onto us. And so I think it's reasonable to assume that Mary and Joseph played a major role in shaping the man that Jesus would become. And so naturally, I wondered, well, how did Mary and Joseph's character impact Jesus? Really, even the rest of their kids. Did you know that, so Jesus had at least four brothers. They're listed in Scripture. He also had at least two sisters. They're not named in Scripture, but sisters there is plural, so it's at least two. So you've got at least seven kids that Mary and Joseph are raising, which is pretty awesome to think about. But I'm thinking, how did Mary and Joseph's character impact Jesus? I mean, is there any evidence for this? Well, if we consider everything that happened around the birth of Jesus and how Mary and Joseph just handled themselves, I think we can see, you know, quite a bit of their character that would eventually be reflected in Jesus. So earlier this morning during the 10 o'clock service, I mentioned that it was a big deal for Mary to be pregnant before the official wedding ceremony. We saw that there's a law in Deuteronomy that said someone like Mary could have been put to death, like legitimately, under the Israelite law. So there's that. I mean, you know, there's that to worry about. But there's another law I actually didn't mention, so I'll just throw this one at you. In the book of Numbers, chapter 5, the Lord said that if a man's wife is unfaithful to him, there's actually a ritual that's performed by the priest where he takes some holy water in a jar and he adds some dust from the floor to it. Sounds a little strange. Also sounds to me like maybe someone should have been sweeping up a little bit more. I don't know. But this is what Scripture says. There's a jar. The priest fills it with holy water. He then throws some dust from the floor to it. And then he writes down on a scroll these curses on the woman. And he immediately washes off the ink from the scroll. And what's been washed off, he dumps that into the jar of water as well. And then he takes the dirty, ink-stained water and he uses it as a test for the wife. If she drinks the water and she's okay, then that's supposed to be a sign that she actually was faithful to her husband, like she didn't sin. But if she drinks the dirty water and she's not okay, then that was a sign that she was unfaithful. By the way, she was not forced to drink this. She had to agree to it. But if she was found guilty of adultery, the scriptures say that she would become a curse among her own people. In other words, everyone would know what she did, and she'd be shamed for her unfaithfulness. She'd become an outcast. In today's language, you know, maybe she'd be canceled, right? And everybody would know that. But now, you know, all of this applied to Mary because she's a Jewish woman and she would have known this law when the angel Gabriel came down and Gabriel told her that she's going to have a child through the Holy Spirit. But like her husband, you know, Joseph, Mary was also faithful to the Lord. And rather than freaking out about what other people might think, here's her response to the angel Gabriel. She says in Luke 1:38, "I am the Lord's servant. May your word be fulfilled in me." And then the angel left her. So in other words, she believed the Lord. She trusted in the Lord in that moment. You know, I found this interesting. I told my family this, and it kind of blew my daughter's mind. Not to pick on you, but Mary was probably around the age of 14 years old when she was first betrothed to Joseph. I picked on my daughter because she's almost 14 as well. So it kind of blows my mind, right, that this 14-year-old girl is being told this from, you know, the angel. Remember, I realize this was over 2,000 years ago. It's in a completely different culture. It's on the other side of the planet, but my brain still can't comprehend this level of maturity from a teenager. But here you go. We have it in Mary, right? She didn't freak out in this moment. She calmly put her trust in the Lord. And I don't want to put words into Mary's mouth, but I think I'm safe to infer that she trusted the Lord that this would not be the end of her marriage. It could have been, but I think she trusted that it wouldn't. I think that she trusted that even if she'd become a social outcast, she's willing to do it because she's serving the Lord. And I think she trusted that she wouldn't be put to death because, you know, if she would have been put to death, she wouldn't have had the child. Right? And Joseph displayed the same kind of trust in the Lord. You know, he had the advantage also of being told by an angel what was going on. So he didn't have to insist on the whole dirty water ritual thing, right? But he and Mary still had to face their family, and they still had to face the small community that they lived in. See, when Jesus was born, they were in a small town, the small town of Bethlehem. That's the town where Joseph grew up. And they stayed there for a while with family until Herod, put out this decree. He had heard from Magi that there'd be this king that rises out of Bethlehem, and so he puts out this decree to kill every male child that's 2 years old and younger in Bethlehem. So one night, while Joseph was dreaming, an angel told him to take Mary and Jesus and escape to Egypt, because Herod is after them, and Herod would want to kill Jesus, right? We don't know how long they stayed in Egypt. Bible scholars only guess. But when it was safe to come back, they actually decided to live in Nazareth instead of Bethlehem. And so I'm going to show you some pictures of Nazareth. There's a map. You can see that Nazareth is pretty far from Jerusalem. Bethlehem's not too far there. They ended up living in Nazareth. And you're going to see the following slides are from when I was in Israel and I visited the town of Nazareth. Now this is like, I guess it's like a mock town where they recreated it so that you can kind of tour through it, and there's people there dressed in like the time period, and they're working. Some of the women are working on fabrics and the guys are working with the tools, and it's a pretty cool place to visit if you ever get the opportunity. So that's what you're looking at here. But Nazareth was the place where Mary grew up. And up until the time Mary and Joseph moved there, Nazareth was not a place of any kind of significance. It's not even listed in any written material prior to the New Testament. So you're not going to find Nazareth in the Old Testament. You're not even going to find Nazareth in any other documents that are older than the New Testament. At least that's what the resources I used said. But that doesn't mean that we don't know anything about Nazareth. We actually know that Nazareth was an old town. By the time of Jesus, by the time he was living in Nazareth, it was already an old town. Archaeological evidence shows that Nazareth was established sometime between the years 2000 and 1600 BC. So by the time you get to when Jesus was born in the first century, it's actually estimated that about 200 to 500 people lived in Nazareth. It's probably almost 100 people here today. And if we stayed long enough and we all lived close enough together, I can imagine that, you know, we'd all get to know each other pretty well. So it's not hard for 200 to 500 people to really know each other in a small town. Now, you know, within that small number of people would have been a lot of Mary's family. So I think it's reasonable to assume that with such a small population, you know, her family probably knew everybody, right? Everybody was in everybody's business. That's basically what I'm getting at. Like, everybody knew everybody. You know, this was a town that was fairly poor. So, you know, Mary and Joseph, they're not a wealthy family either. It was a self-sustaining town, which means that it was agricultural. They grew their own crops. You know, some people were farmers. Others worked in some kind of trade. Joseph, our scripture says that he was actually a carpenter. Interestingly enough, there are two different Greek words for the word carpenter. And I know two of our young adults in our congregation, one of which is here. This will be interesting to you. So if you were a carpenter in the time of Jesus, the Greek word there is tekton. Tekton is just a regular, average, everyday carpenter. But if you were an architekton, you were a master carpenter. That's where we get the English word architect, okay? So Joseph, he wasn't an architekton. He's just a regular old tekton. But the thing is, I don't know about you, but when I think of carpenter, I think of someone that works with wood. So we have someone here, Dale Byler, who works with wood, and I've been very impressed with what he can do with wood. He actually makes wooden toys for his grandchildren, which is awesome. So if you didn't know that, ask him about it. I'm sure he'll be happy to show you. I think of the guy that built my Ninja Warrior course in my backyard out of wood. when I think of carpenter, right? I think of someone that can frame a house. I think of someone that can build tables, right? But Joseph probably wasn't that kind of carpenter because he lived in Galilee. In fact, in Galilee, there's just not a lot of trees. There's not a lot of trees in Israel in general. So when I visited Israel and we stopped at that Nazareth location, we learned that Joseph was actually more of a stone mason. He worked with stones. And in the first century in Israel, their buildings, their houses, they're all made out of uncut stone for their walls. They use mud and straw for their roofing. So, the point here is that here we've got this young, probably struggling family living in this poor town where everybody knew everybody's name. What's that show? Cheers, there it is. Thank you. Oh, man. Yeah, good stuff. But they're in this town and Joseph is working during the day, probably going out to the next town over or whatever to do his job and all that. And Mary's staying at home and taking care of what needed to be done at home. And they've just come back from hiding in Egypt. And instead of going back to Bethlehem where Jesus was born, they went to live in Nazareth. Again, the same town that Mary grew up in. Small town. Everyone knew everyone. And it's a safe bet that it's not a safe bet. Everyone knew Mary was pregnant before she and Joseph consummated their marriage. In fact, the Gospel of Luke hints that everyone assumed Mary and Joseph gave in to temptation before their wedding ceremony. Check this out. Luke 3 says, "Now Jesus himself was about 30 years old when he began his ministry. He was the son, so it was thought, of Joseph." Right? So imagine raising your family in a small town. Everyone knows your business, and everyone assumed that you did something that was against the Jewish law. But again, the thing is, when the angel Gabriel gave Mary and Joseph the news about Jesus, they knew that everyone was going to assume that they lived in sin. They knew that there was that real risk and reality that they could be social outcasts. But again, think about how Mary and Joseph responded to the angel. They didn't freak out. They didn't try to plan their lives so that they kind of explain the story, to everyone, and everyone would be okay. They decided to just be faithful, no matter what the cost. So back when Mary heard the news of her pregnancy from the angel, I thought it was interesting. Rather than locking herself, behind locked doors, like the disciples did after Jesus died, rather than hiding from everybody, she actually went to visit her relative, Elizabeth. And she told Elizabeth the news of her pregnancy. And then she sang a song of praise to the Lord. And when Elizabeth heard the news from Mary, she wasn't like, "What? You did what? What happened? What?" No, she wasn't judgmental. She believed Mary's story because Elizabeth was also blessed in a similar way with a child from the Lord. So I wanted you to see how Elizabeth responded to Mary when Mary gave her the news. She said this in Luke 1:45. "Blessed is she," meaning Mary, "blessed is she who has believed that the Lord would fulfill his promises to her." So Mary put her faith in the Lord before her fear of what others might think. And that's why Mary could sing these words. I'm not going to sing them for you, but I'll read them. From Luke 1:46-55, it says, Mary said, "My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name. She continues. She says, His mercy extends to those who fear Him from generation to generation. He has performed mighty deeds with His arm. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, but has lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, but has sent the rich away empty. He has helped His servant Israel, remembering to be merciful to Abraham and his descendants forever, just as He promised our ancestors. And so, you know, I think about this response that Mary had. What a testament to faith over fear. What a testament to how her character and even Joseph's character influenced Jesus and the rest of their children. I'm not surprised that we see their character reflected in the actions of Jesus. So, you know, maybe the lesson for us this evening as we reflect on the gift of Jesus is that no matter what life throws our way, we don't have to fear because we serve the Prince of Peace. We serve Jesus. We don't have to fear what others think. We don't have to live in fear out of our own life circumstances. Even if we're walking through that valley of the shadow of death, we don't have to fear because Jesus promised to always be with us. And He promised to walk with us through those dark valleys. And He promised even to be our Prince of Peace. Look at what He says. John 14. Jesus says, Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid. And I got to throw one more verse in there because it's awesome. Jesus said in John 16, He said, I've told you these things so that in Me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble. Let that sink in. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart. I have overcome the world. So this Christmas season, let's take heart. Let's not give in to fear. Let's keep lifting our eyes to the Lord. And let's find our courage and our peace in the One who gives the kind of peace that Scripture says transcends all understanding. Let's pray. Jesus, thank You. Thank You for taking on our sins. Thank You for dying the death that You didn't deserve. Thank You for courageously approaching the cross on our behalf. Thank You for adopting us into Your family. Lord, may we never lose sight of You. Lord, help us to not allow our anxieties and our fears to overcome us because we know You've already overcome the world. Help us to feel Your presence in those moments when we really do need Your strength. And Lord, this Christmas season, may we not forget the real reason for the season, and that is You and the hope that You give to this world. Not just hope, but assurance that whoever puts their trust in You will be saved, will be adopted into Your family. So, Lord, we thank You for that. I pray that this message would continue to be on our minds this week as we visit with family, as maybe memories of maybe hurtful, painful memories rise up in our minds and in our hearts. I pray that You would give us that peace that transcends all understanding. And we thank You, Lord. We praise You. We pray in Your matchless name, Jesus. Amen.
Would you stand and sing with us again? Sing Silent Night now, and I just want to give a couple instructions for the candles. Just go ahead and take your candles out and can light from the center on out. Just make sure you always keep the lit candle vertical and tilt a unlit candle to meet it. We're going to go ahead and sing this together, and at the end of each verse, we're going to raise our candles up, see them nice and high. Elvin, you can go ahead and cut the lights.
Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright, round yon virgin mother and child, holy infant so tender and mild, sleep in heavenly peace, sleep in heavenly peace. Silent night, holy night, shepherds quake at the sight, glory stream from heaven afar, heavenly hosts sing alleluia, Christ the Savior is born. Christ the Savior is born. Silent night, holy night, Son of God, bless your radiant beams from thy holy face, with the dawn of redeeming grace. Jesus, Lord, at thy birth, Jesus, Lord, silent night, holy night, wondrous star, lend thy light, with the angels let us sing. Savior is born. Christ the Savior is born.
Jesus, we are so grateful and excited and just ready to celebrate your birthday tomorrow. Just thank you for the fact that you came at all, that you loved us enough to come, knowing everything that was ahead of you, and knowing that we would continue to mess up at times, and just what a messy thing life can be sometimes, but you still came. And I just pray a blessing on our Christmas tomorrow. God, we, like I said, we may be excited, we may be nervous, or maybe, you know, somebody's missing this year or something like that, or maybe our plans have just, I don't know, falling apart, or maybe they're going great. But Jesus, you are here tonight and you're in tomorrow already. And I just pray that that it won't be about the traditions or everything going according to plan. But I pray that there will be so many little moments tonight and tomorrow and in the days to come that we see your light and feel your presence. And I just thank you for that. And just happy birthday. Amen.
Amen. You are dismissed.